Order! Order! You are an incorrigible delinquent at times. Behave yourself, man! The Secretary of State for exiting the European Union. Yeah. Secretary David Davis.
With permission, Mr. Speaker, I will now make a statement on the government's response to today's judgment by the Supreme Court. This government is determined to deliver on the decision taken by the people of the United Kingdom in the referendum granted to them by this House to leave the European Union. So we will move swiftly to do just that. I can announce today that we will shortly introduce legislation allowing the government to move ahead with invoking Article 50, which starts the formal process of withdrawing from the European Union. Now, we received the lengthy 96-page judgment just a few hours ago, and government lawyers are assessing it carefully. But this will be a straightforward bill. It's not about whether or not the UK should leave the European Union. That decision has already been made by the people of the United Kingdom. We will work with colleagues in both houses to ensure this bill is passed in good time for us to invoke Article 50 by the end of March this year, as my right honourable friend the Prime Minister has set out. This timetable has already been supported by this House. Now let me go through the issues step by step. The government's priority following the European Union referendum has been to respect the outcome and to ensure it's delivered in the interests of the whole country. This House voted by 6-1 to put the decision in the hands of voters, and that bill passed the other place unopposed. So there can be no going back. The point of no return was passed on June 23rd last year. The government's also always been clear that we must leave by following the process set out in Article 50 of the Treaty on European Union. People want and expect us to get on with implementing the decision that was made. Now, let me turn specifically to the process for invoking Article 50 now and the issues that arise from today's Supreme Court judgment. The government's view, which we argued in both High Court and subsequently the Supreme Court, was it was constitutionally proper and lawful for the government to begin to give effect to the decision of the people by the use of prerogative powers to invoke Article 50. Today, the Supreme Court has agreed with the High Court's judgment that the prerogative power alone is insufficient to give notice under Article 50, and that legislation is required in order to provide the necessary authorisation for this step. In addition, the Supreme Court considered the roles of devolved legislatures in the process of triggering Article 50. On this, the Supreme Court ruled that, and I quote from the summary, relations with the EU and other foreign affairs matters are reserved to the United Kingdom government and Parliament, not to devolved institutions. The Supreme Court summary goes on to say that devolved legislatures do not have a veto on the UK's decision to withdraw from the European Union. Now, I'll come back to our collaboration with the devolved administrations later in this statement. The government's been giving careful thought to the steps that we would need to take in the event of the Supreme Court upholding the High Court's view. First of all, let me be clear that we believe in and value the independence of our judiciary, the foundation upon which the rule of law is built. So, of course, it goes without saying, we will respect this judgment. Second, as I've already made clear, this judgment does not change the fact that the UK will be leaving the European Union, and it's our job to deliver on the instruction the people of the UK have given us. Third, we will, within days, introduce legislation to give the government the legal power to trigger Article 50 and begin the formal process of withdrawal. It will be separate to the Great Repeal Bill that will be introduced later this year to repeal the European Communities Act 1972. This will be the most straightforward bill possible to give effect to the decision of the people and respect the Supreme Court's judgment. The purpose of this bill is simply to give the government the power to invoke Article 50 and begin the process of leaving the European Union. That's what the British people voted for, and it's what they would expect. Parliament will rightly scrutinise and debate this legislation, but I trust no one will seek to make it a vehicle for attempts to thwart the will of the people or frustrate or delay the process of exit the European Union. Fourth, our timetable for invoking Article 50 by the end of March still stands. That timetable has given valuable certainty to citizens and businesses in the UK and across Europe. It's understood by our European partners and provides a framework for planning the negotiation ahead. This House itself backed that timetable by a majority of 373 in December. So we look forward to working closely with colleagues in Parliament to ensure that the legislation on Article 50 is passed in good time to allow us to invoke it by the end of March as planned. The government's fifth and final principle for responding to judgment is to continue to ensure that we deliver an exit that's in the best interests of the whole of the United Kingdom. The Supreme Court has ruled clearly in the government's favour on roles of devolved legislatures in invoking Article 50. But whilst this provides welcome clarity, it in no way diminishes our commitment to work closely with the people and administrations of Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland as we move forward with our withdrawal from the European Union. Let me conclude with a word on what today's judgment means to the UK and the nature of our democracy. I know that this case, on an issue of such importance which arouses strong views on all sides, has not been without controversy. But the court was asked a question. A proper, thorough and independent process was gone through, and it has given its answer in law. We're a law-abiding nation. Indeed, the UK is known the world over for the strength and independence of its judicial system. We will build on this and our many other strengths as we leave the European Union. We will once again be a fully independent, sovereign country, free to make our own decisions. Our Prime Minister has already set out a comprehensive plan, including our core negotiating objectives. She's been clear that we want a new, positive and constructive partnership for the UK and the EU, a partnership that will be good for the UK and good for the rest of Europe. Today, we are taking the necessary step to respect the Supreme Court's decision by announcing a bill. It will be up to this Parliament to respect the decision it entrusted to the people of the United Kingdom, a decision they took on the June 23rd. I commend this statement to the House.
Yeah. Keir Starmer. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the Secretary of State for early sight of his statement. This is a good day for parliamentary sovereignty. Yeah. The Supreme Court has ruled that we shall have a say in this House on the Article 50 issue. Given the issues involved, that is quite right, and the Prime Minister was wrong to have attempted to sideline Parliament in this process. This bill is only to be introduced because the Prime Minister has been ordered to do so. Now, I hope in the aftermath there won't be the attacks on our judges that there were when the High Court gave its ruling. And it's the duty of all of us to defend them if they do, and to do so quickly. And I hope the Secretary of State will join me in that endeavour. The question now moves on to the proper role of Parliament, and the Supreme Court said nothing about the particular form of legislation. But on issues as important as this, it'd be wrong for the government to try to minimise the role of Parliament or to seek to avoid amendments. And I ask the Secretary of State to confirm that he won't take that approach. This is a question of substance, not process. Last week, the Prime Minister committed herself to swapping the known benefits of single market membership and the customs union for the hoped for benefits of a free trade agreement with a fallback position of breaking our economic model. That is high risk, and there are big gaps, inconsistencies and unanswered questions in the Prime Minister's approach. Mr. Speaker, if the Prime Minister fails in her endeavour, the cost will be borne by families, working people and communities throughout the UK. The stakes are high, and the role of this House in holding the Prime Minister and the government to account throughout the process is crucial. Yes. Labour accepts and respects the referendum result and will not frustrate the process. But we will be seeking to lay amendments to ensure proper scrutiny and accountability throughout the process. That starts, Mr. Speaker, with a white paper or plan. A speech is not a white paper or plan, and we need something to hold the government to account throughout the process. Can't have a speech as the only basis for accountability for 2 years or more. That's the first step. There needs to be a reporting back procedure, and there needs to be a meaningful vote at the end of the exercise. The government should welcome such scrutiny, not try to resist it, because the end result would be better if scrutinised than it would otherwise be. Yeah. I hope the Secretary of State will confirm that we will not seek to minimise scrutiny and accountability. I'll leave others to say about the devolved administrations, but I think whatever the court ruled, it is important that those interests are taken properly into account. I end with this, Mr. Speaker. What a waste of time and money. The High Court decision was 82 days ago. The Prime Minister could have accepted then to introduce a bill. We could have debated the issues. And I'd like the Secretary of State to lay out what the cost to the taxpayer have been of this appeal. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Secretary of State.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let me say this to the Honourable Gentleman. The Prime Minister was not aiming to sideline democracy. She was aiming...
Order, just so the right honourable gentleman resume his seat. The House is in an understandably excited and excitable state. But what I just want to say to colleagues is that they don't have to look into the crystal ball when they can read the book. Members should know by now that I always want to facilitate the fullest possible questioning and scrutiny, and it's right that that should happen. But it's also right that when the Secretary of State is responding to questions, he's given a fair and courteous hearing. Secretary of State.
She was aiming to carry out the will of the people, 17.4 million of them, in the national interest. That was what the Prime Minister is doing. Now, if I may just pick up on the point that the Honourable Gentleman quite properly raised, the issue of our judges. I think I mentioned at length three times in my statement that this is a nation of the rule of law, a nation in which the independence of the judiciary is important, and it's something which is watched in this country by other countries as an example to themselves. So, and all the people he could criticise that. I don't think I'm at the front of the issue. Now, similarly on the question of going the process through Parliament, there's been an interesting sort of litany through this whole process in the last 6-7 months. Every single time I get up and I say that I will give the House as much information as possible, subject to not undermining the national interest, not undermining our negotiating position. And that is what we have done, and it's what we will continue to do, not just through this bill, but also through the Great Repeal Bill, subsequent primary legislation, subsequent secondary legislation, and the final vote at the end, which we have promised. He talked about membership of the single market, putting to one side, of course, that to have membership of the single market, you have to give up control of your own borders, control of your own laws, control of the rules, all of which, of course, the Labour Party is singularly incapable of even making a decision on, let alone coming up with a policy on. And he talks about a plan. I mean, the Prime Minister, last week, gave a 6,500-word, closely argued speech, which has been recognised on all sides of this country and all around Europe as an epitome of clarity, of very clear objectives, very clear aims, very clear ambitions for this country. So I don't take that point at all. Now, on the point more generally of scrutiny, we have now had, I think, 5 statements, 10 debates, some 30 different select committee inquiries. I hardly think in 6 months that is an absence of scrutiny of a central government policy. And on his, I mean, I have to say, I was a little, I mean, the Honourable Gentleman doesn't often surprise me, but for the ex director of public prosecutions to say that the Supreme Court is a waste of time, or taking a matter to the Supreme Court is a waste of time, strikes me as quite extraordinary. Quite extraordinary. I made this point a number of times in the last few months. One of the reasons for taking this, once this process has started, a reason for taking it the full distance is in order to get the most authoritative and clearest possible guidance in terms of a major part of our Constitution. So I don't really think, yet again, the Honourable Gentleman has advanced the knowledge of the House very much, but I look forward to the contributions of other members.
Mr. Kenneth Clark.
Mr. Speaker, has my right honourable friend yet had the opportunity to note that my recently published memoirs are cited with approval. They're cited with approval in paragraph 195 of the judgment. And does he share my surprise that that is a minority dissenting judgment? Where they say, more seriously, does my right honourable friend accept that parliamentary sovereignty has always meant that governments of the day pursue broad policy objectives in the national interest and quite willingly submit them to the judgment of the House, both debates and to votes, and they only proceed with broad policy objectives when they have the support of a majority in the House of Commons. So would he give me the government's assurance that this bill will be drafted on the basis that it improves the opportunities for the government to give or withhold its consent to major policy objectives? And will it pursue that approach in future years? Because surely having one vote right at the end of the process, where the House will be told it either takes the deal the government's got or goes into the alternative chaos of having no agreements with the EU or anybody else, is not a very good substitute for the normal tradition of Parliament consenting to the policy aims of the government of the day.
My right honourable friend and I have been skirmishing over this issue, I think for some 30 years, always with good humour. And I will hope to respond to him in the same vein today. Let me just take this characterisation. He repeated it on television earlier. Let's take this characterisation of what the government is proposing. As I said, we've already had 10 debates and vast numbers of other arguments. But in terms of what's going to happen going forward, one, we're going to have a bill to authorise the triggering of Article 50. Then we're going to have a great repeal bill, which is going to go through the entire corpus of European law as it applies to the United Kingdom. And that will go on, I should think, for a considerable amount of time. We're then going to have primary legislation on major policy changes that are coming, all again in front of the House, and secondary legislation again in front of the House, both houses. And at the end of it, not just one vote, but at the end of it, we're going to have the vote which eventually decides whether the House supports the policy that we are proposing or not. And let me make it plain. That policy will be aimed solely at advancing the interest of the United Kingdom, at giving the best possible negotiated outcome that we can achieve. Having taken on board the informing debate of this House of Commons over the entire 2 years in the run-up to it.
Stephen Githins.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Firstly, can I welcome the judgment in anything which strengthens parliamentary scrutiny over this process? Yeah. There was a time when the Secretary of State himself was a great champion of parliamentary scrutiny back in the dim and distant past. I'm sure that deep down inside he will be welcoming this judgment as well.
Welcome.
And I'm wondering why they fear parliamentary scrutiny. Is it because they might be found out?
Yeah.
Is it because we'll find out that the Emperor in these circumstances has no clothes? Because they talk of democracy. And as a gentle reminder in terms of democracy, let me remind the Secretary of State of this. That when it comes to Scotland, the Conservatives got their worst result at the general election since 1865. You have one MP. Furthermore, what we are told today is that this is a political decision. And as a political decision over the role of the devolved administrations, I hope that this Parliament and this Government will continue to not legislate on areas that are a responsibility of the Scottish Parliament without its consent. And actually, the judgment today, Mr. Speaker, said that this should enhance devolution. If that is the case, will the Secretary of State tell us today that no powers will be returned from the Scottish Parliament to Westminster during the course of this process? And will he seek consent from the Scottish Parliament before legislating on areas over which it has responsibility? Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
A Again, I'm surprised at the honourable gentleman. The I would have thought that of all people, the Scottish Nationalist Party would give great importance to the electoral results in the Scottish Parliament, in which the Conservative Party came second this time under the inestimable Ruth Davison. Now, but to the point, to the main point of his question, I want to make two points to it. Firstly. The process that we have gone through with all the devolved administrations, the joint ministerial process, has been going on now for some months and monthly meetings. At the very last one, we had a presentation from Mike Russell, the Scottish Government Minister, on the whole question of the Scottish Government's proposals, some of which we disagree with, some of which we agree with absolutely, for example, the protection of employment law, and some of which we will be debating in the coming weeks and months, most particularly to the point he raised, the question of devolution and devolved powers. Now, he knows I'm a devolutionist, and I can say to him firmly, that there will be no powers existing in the devolved administrations that are going to come back, but there will be powers that will come from the European Union, which we have to decide where they most properly land, whether it's Westminster, Holyrood, or whatever. And the real issue there is the practical interests of all of the nations of the United Kingdom. So, for example, preserving the single market of the United Kingdom. For example, preserving the ability of the United Kingdom to do international deals. There are a whole series of areas which are just as important to the ordinary Scot as they are to the ordinary English, Welsh, or Northern Irish citizen. And that's what we will protect.
Yeah. Mr. Ian Duncan Smith.
Mr. Speaker, can I say to my right honourable friend that the very fact that this was a split judgment shows that the Prime Minister, our right honourable friend the Prime Minister, was absolutely right to take this case all the way to get a full decision. And can I ask him to resist our right honourable and learned and much respected friend in not overcomplicating this? After all, the question here is, should the government trigger Article 50? Yeah. So may I urge him, when he brings this in front of us, to keep it short, to keep it simple, and most of all, keep it swift.
Yeah.
Well, we'll keep it straightforward is what we'll certainly do. He's right. This is a unique circumstance in many ways. Unique in terms of the importance of the kingdom, but unique also in the fact that it's carrying out the will of 17.5 million people who voted directly, something that's never happened before in our history. So it was important to take it to the Supreme Court to get the full outcome, and I can give him this undertaking. I'll do everything in my power to make sure it goes through swiftly, that it's properly scrutinised, but that it is a simple, straightforward bill that delivers the triggering of Article 50 by March 31st.
Mr. Hilary Benn.
Very much, Mr. Speaker. Having tried to argue in court that Parliament should not decide on the triggering of Article 50 and lost, will the Secretary of State now agree to accept the unanimous recommendation of the Brexit Select Committee and in the process agree with himself before he got this job and now publish a white paper on the government's objectives so that these can be considered alongside the legislation that he has just announced? Because if the government does not do so, then I have to say to him, it will be showing a lack of respect for this House of Commons.
I don't often disagree with myself, but let me say this to the Honourable Gentleman. Right, Honourable Gentleman. The speech given last week by the Prime Minister was the clearest exposition of a negotiating strategy I have seen in modern times. It laid out very clearly what we judge the national interest to be, how we intend to protect it, what we want to do, what we hope does not happen, and how we're going to go about avoiding that too. So I don't see that this government has avoided answering any question, either from his committee or indeed from the front bench. The only questions that we have been unable to answer are those which would be to the disadvantage of the country in terms of undermining our negotiating strategy. And I'll give one example to him. I mean, it's not him, but it's my opponent, as it were, the Honourable Gentleman, the spokesman for the opposition, who on Channel 4 not very long ago, a couple of weeks ago, said, well, what we want to know is whether the government will pay for access to the single market and how much will it pay. Well, if anything would undermine a negotiating position, that would. And it's precisely that sort of thing we are going to avoid. We will continue to give information to the House. I gave his committee an undertaking. We'll give at least as much information as we'll give as we'll go to the European Parliament. Indeed, more, I think. And we will continue to keep the House informed throughout the entire process, which is not going to be over in a few weeks. It's going to last 2 years, and the House will be as well informed on this as it's been on anything of such importance.
Sir William Cash.
Speaker, the Supreme Court this morning ruled that the form of the bill, I quote, is entirely a matter for Parliament. It was also indicated by them that the issues before the Supreme Court have nothing to do with the political merits of the decision to withdraw, or the timetable, the terms of so doing, or any future relationship between the UK and the EU. So will my right honourable friend confirm that as respects any potential amendments, the bill itself will be short and tightly drawn to give effect exclusively to the Supreme Court decision itself?
Yeah.
Well, the short answer is yes. I mean, he was citing to me, I think, section 122 of the court's decision and its commentary. And the point of this bill is to meet the requirements of the Supreme Court, to deliver the instruction from the nation at large, and to do it in the national interest. That means a straightforward, easily comprehensible bill that the country at large can see what Parliament is doing and what decision it's visiting on the government. That's what we will do.
Yvette Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I agree with the Minister that Parliament must respect the result of the referendum, but I hope that he will also agree that the government does not have a blank check either from Parliament or the public over what kind of Brexit it now pursues. He said that there will be votes in the process. So can he tell us, given that the government has said it is ruling out being in the customs union, in the common external tariff, and the common commercial policy, and he knows that there are strongly held views on different sides about the impact that will have on our manufacturing industry, which will be so crucial to our future, when will he give Parliament a vote on that decision?
Well, so a couple of things, the Honourable Lady. Firstly, you know, we're asked on one hand to tell the House what our plan is, and then we're told, oh, but we don't like that, so we want to have a debate or a white paper or whatever on that. The simple truth, no, it's fine. I perfectly understand the argument. The simple truth here is that there will be any number of votes, I mean, too many to count in the next 2 years across a whole range of issues. I can see, for example, the sort of issues she's raising coming up in the Great Repeal Bill. I can see it coming up in subsequent primary legislation, maybe even in subsequent major secondary legislation as well. So I'm quite sure there will be votes in that subject area, a number of them, in the next 2 years.
John Redwood.
If someone votes against sending the Article 50 letter, aren't they voting against restoring the very parliamentary sovereignty that they call in aid? Doesn't the British people want a proper parliament, not a puppet parliament answering to Brussels? And doesn't that require sending the letter soon?
What it requires is leaving the European Union, and that's what we're going to do.
Kate Hoey.
Does the Minister accept that the public, in my view, that the public want us to get on with this and actually carry out what they voted for? But does he also accept, too, that the public will not look lightly on amendments that are being brought in, particularly by parties that actually want another referendum, to delay unnecessarily, but do want, perhaps, amendments that clarify and make us all more aware of the government's intentions?
The Honourable Lady, as ever, goes right to the heart of the matter. The public will not view well attempts to thwart this process, to delay this process, to confuse this process. They will view well attempts to elucidate what's going on, promote the national interest, help the negotiating position, and so on. And that's entirely what the government's going to do.
Anna Soubry.
Mr. Speaker.
Yeah.
Mr. Speaker, there is a genuine desire, I believe, for people to come together to support the government, to build a consensus to get the best deal possible. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, we've abandoned the single market, We've abandoned the free movement of people without any debate, never mind a vote, in this place.
A referendum.
And on that basis, Mr. Well, somebody just said we've had a referendum. There was one question on the paper, leave or remain. And we are leaving the European Union. That is accepted. But as I've asked, and I take my right honourable friends as a man of his word, when I voted in that motion in December, it was a two-part motion. Personally, I didn't agree that with the triggering at the end of March, but I voted for it in the spirit that we would have a plan. I would like a white paper which we could debate. It will bring us together, I would say to my right honourable friend. What has my right honourable friend got to lose with a debate on a white paper?
Let me say this to the honourable lady. She holds passionately a very well-formed view on these matters. That the, firstly, in terms of bringing people together, a large part of the Prime Minister's speech was aimed at creating a sense of this country which everybody can get behind, ranging from protection of employment rights through to our role in the world. All of them very, very important. Secondly, she laid out an incredibly clear future for us and a future approach for us. So I think that she did everything one could ask of a Prime Minister to deliver on those undertakings. The point I'd make to her now is that she says, well, these things weren't on the ballot paper. What was on the ballot paper was leaving the European Union. I'm afraid it's very difficult to see how you can leave the European Union and still stay inside the single market with all the commitments that go with that. What we have come up with, and I hope to persuade her that this is a very worthwhile aim. What we've come up with is the idea of a comprehensive free trade agreement and a comprehensive customs agreement, which will deliver the exact same benefits as we have there, but also enable my right honourable friend to be able to go and form those trade deals with the rest of the world too, which is a real upside of leaving the European Union.
At McFadden.
Last week in her speech, the Prime Minister said, and I quote, "The government will put the final deal that is agreed between the UK and the EU to a vote in both Houses of Parliament before it comes into force." The Article 50 negotiation is not the final deal.
Yeah.
The final deal is the future trading agreement between the UK and the EU. So can the Secretary of State confirm that Parliament will get a vote on both the Article 50 agreement and, as the Prime Minister said, the final deal? And what will happen if Parliament says no to the terms of either of these agreements?
The answer to the overall question is yes. We are standing by both of those and we'll continue to do so. But the point I will reiterate to him again is they won't be the only votes. There'll be a large number of other votes in between. The Labour Party can ignore it till the cows come home, but the simple truth is they're going to have many, many, many votes on many different policy areas after very extensive debate on primary legislation. So the answer is the Parliament will have a great influence on this process and it will have the final say. That, I think, a democracy in action.
Graham Paterson.
Further to that last reply, my right honourable friend has given us admirable clarity on Article 50 in the timetable. Could he give us a little more information on his current thoughts on the timetable of the Great Repeal Bill?
Well, it will be in the Queen's speech, and it will be very soon thereafter that it is presented to the House, because I expect it to be debated extensively. I think it will be the centrepiece and the start of a major debate about the nature of this country in the future, and therefore it is important to get it in front of the House very early.
Caroline Lucas.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The final vote offered by his government on the negotiated package is not a meaningful vote unless the government guarantees as well that if there is a vote against the withdrawal treaty, there will be an option to continue talks with the EU for a better deal rather than simply falling out with no deal at all. Can he guarantee that we will have that vote in time for that further discussion to happen?
Let me make this point to the Honourable Lady. I mean, this is of a piece with those arguments that said we want to have a second referendum so we can revisit. Yeah. Because what it does is it gives a prize to somebody trying to put up the worst possible negotiation for us. Because there are plenty of members in the European Union who want to force us into changing our mind and going back inside. And we do not want to do anything which allows or encourages that to happen. But she is not right to say that this vote is meaningless. For a start, the Select Committee and the opposition both asked for it beforehand. Secondarily, it will be, I repeat again, the last of many, many, many votes and debates on major legislation.
Dr. Julian Lewis.
Hard Brexit means saying that one is going to leave the European Union and actually doing it. Soft Brexit means saying one is going to leave the European Union and remaining in all but name. Which course does the government intend to follow?
In his younger days, my honourable friend was an expert in Soviet propaganda. I'm afraid I view hard Brexit and soft Brexit as terms of propaganda.
Emma Reynolds.
Can the Secretary of State guarantee that this House will have the ability to both scrutinise and vote on the agreement between the UK and the EU27 at the same time that that agreement is put before the European Parliament?
As I repeat again, they'll have the opportunity over and over and over again in a whole series of primary legislation, secondary legislation, and finally on the vote itself. How the timing of that will coincide with the European Parliament, I've not given a great deal of thought to. I will do, and I'll write to her.
Mr. Dominic Grieve.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My right honourable friend will be aware that in the course of the court case, great stress was laid by the government on the irrevocability, in its opinion, of Article 50.
Accepted by the court.
And in those circumstances, I'm sure my right honourable friend can understand that the problem facing the House is that in triggering Article 50, that irrevocability has to be matched against the excellent words of my right honourable friend, the Prime Minister, setting out a plan which he envisages a future relationship with the European Union from outside of it. In those circumstances, could I urge my right honourable friend to keep in mind that the debate on Article 50 is likely to be greatly facilitated if the ideas expressed by the Prime Minister are put into a white paper or similar document, to which, in fact, reference can be made in the triggering of Article 50 without fettering the government's discretion in its negotiations thereafter. Because ultimately, he may agree with me, this comes down to an issue of trust. And if the government can build that trust, it will greatly facilitate its task, and if I may say so, those such as myself who wish to help the government in what it is trying to achieve.
My right honourable friend, my old friend, tempts me down a route, but I'm just going to answer him in these terms. In the case, the argument put by the government did not depend upon the irrevocability or otherwise of the legal issue in front of us. It depended on the fact that we view the irrevocable moment as being June the 23rd last year, and that it's not actually in the gift of the government to change its mind. So we've already passed the point of no return. In terms of information, I have said over and over again, I will provide what information I can, as much information as I can, without undermining our negotiated position. And I'll continue to do so through the Article 50 process and beyond.
Gisela Stewart.
We all know that negotiations are two-way processes, and we accept that our European partners may not be able to agree on anything until the German and French elections are out of the way. However, in the meantime, there's a logic to why Article 50 should be triggered by the end of March. It has to do with a two-year process so that by the time we've got the next European elections, we will have completed that process. And it's therefore important not just to remind colleagues in this House, but probably colleagues in the other House, that there's a logic to an end of March date.
The Honourable Lady, as ever, again gets the point of the matter. There are many reasons for the triggering by the end of March. The rather obvious ones, that the public want us to get on with it, and that includes Remainers as well as Leavers in terms of the old vote. There are practical reasons of business uncertainty. The longer we spin this out, the more difficult it is both for businesses and workers about their own future. But she's also right that it fits very neatly. It's a sort of sweet spot, I guess, in terms of delivering an outcome which is in our interests in the European timetables, both in the... There are 15... the House should understand, there are roughly 15 elections between now and the end of the process, and then there is a European parliamentary election at the end, which, if we get too close to it, could compromise the vote at the end. So there are a whole series of reasons why the end of March is incredibly important. It is not an arbitrary date, it's a date designed to uphold the strength of the negotiations. So she's right on the nail.
Mr. Alistair Burt.
Speaker, as one who campaigned to remain in the European Union, can I say I welcome the decision of the court today, which gives me the opportunity to show that I accept the result of the referendum. I will vote for the bill triggering Article 50. Could I also say, at the risk of repetition, that it would help still further the authority of the House and the authority with which the Prime Minister goes into the negotiations, if he would indeed take on board the unanimous view of the Select Committee and the view expressed by the Chairman of the Select Committee and others, that the way in which the Prime Minister set out with the clarity of her expression about the plan is only enhanced, and the work of the House, which is endorsed by the Supreme Court judgment, is equally enhanced by the publication of that and the opportunity to debate and cover a number of things which the bill cannot itself cover.
Well said. Yeah. I thank my honourable friend for the tone of his question, and the it's a very good question, and the issue here is not information. I've said over and over again, I'll provide as much information as is consistent with actually with the House's previous motions on this, not undermining our negotiating position. And that's what we will do. We will provide as much information as possible, but bear in mind, the Article 50 bill is going to be presented quite quickly to the House, so we don't have a great deal of time either.
Luciana Berger.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today's Supreme Court ruling really is a victory for transparency and openness, but a half-hour speech by the Prime Minister outside of this House with a couple of questions to the media is no substitute for parliamentary scrutiny. Yeah. Will the Secretary of State please take on board the views of members of all sides of this House and please bring forward a white paper, which I think will unite this House in order to forge a way forward?
Yeah. I've been at this dispatch box on statements alone 5 times in the last 5 months, and I am at great risk of boring the House. But I just repeat to her what I've said already: the maximum possible information, the maximum possible debate is what we will deliver.
Nicky Morgan.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Speaker. I think this House should be grateful to both the Supreme Court and to the High Court for asserting parliamentary sovereignty and allowing us to have a say on the Article 50 process. And I agree with my right honourable friend who spoke and said he would vote in favour of Article 50. I will too. But in the spirit of the question from my right honourable friend, the member for Chingford and Woodford Green, who called for a swift passage of the bill, and I would agree with him, does my right honourable friend not agree that when Parliament voted, the House voted for the motion in December, it wasn't just in relation to the 31st of March deadline, it was also in relation to the publication of a plan. And I would suggest to him that the passage of the bill will be swifter if a white paper is published and debates happen on that too, and the bill, the Article 50 process, is separate. Yeah.
I hear what my right honourable friend says. I just have to. I'm becoming very boring and reiterating the same point, that we will provide as much information as I possibly can, subject to not undermining our position.
Is Brendan McNeill?
Yeah. In 2014 in Scotland, we were told we had a powerhouse parliament and were an equal partner in the UK. We know from this morning that we're not the equal of Wallonia and Belgium, and we will not be consulted on Brexit. And with the turbocharged cowardice of the leader of the Labour Party, it is clear that Scotland will now be taken out against our will. As the UK government pursues Brexit, Scotland must take the opportunity of an independence referendum. Meantime, as the Scottish Parliament is not being consulted, will at least the views of Scottish members of Parliament in this House be taken into account and respected?
My answer to the honourable gentleman, another old friend of mine, is of course. I mean, I have spent a very great deal of time also speaking directly to the Scottish Government, and while we're at it, the Welsh Government and the Northern Irish Executive too. And I consider it incredibly important that in this process we protect the interests of the people he represents, the interests of the people of Scotland in this negotiation.
Mr. Crispin Blunt.
Speaker, I welcome the Secretary of State's commitment to be giving as much information as he can to the House and its committees. In that instance, could he explain why the government isn't providing any evidence to the Foreign Affairs Committee's inquiry into the practical consequences of leaving the European Union after 2 years with no agreement in place, an outcome that is a distinct possibility and one over which the government cannot command the outcome? And surely it would be best for the country and every single company in the land that would be affected by this to understand the consequences as clearly as possible so they can plan for it.
As I said, we'll provide as much information as we can. One of the things I would point out to him, however, is that this is a question of a negotiation and we do not know where the end game will be. The rather stark example he cites might have aspects which are different. He's talking about, presumably, about the trade aspect, but there's also justice and home affairs. There are just so many different things to assess. It would be nothing more, frankly, than an exercise in guesswork at this stage.
Angela Eagle.
Mr. Speaker, today the government has been humiliated in the Supreme Court. It has been taught a lesson about the real meaning of parliamentary sovereignty and taking back control. Will the Secretary of State now accept this verdict in the spirit as well as the letter of the ruling and finally concede that this House needs votes along the way, not simply debates without votes, and proper parliamentary scrutiny, so together, working across this House, we can bring the country to the best possible deal in the interests of all of our areas up and down this country?
I'll say two things. I mean, firstly, I really recommend she reads the judgment rather than trying to interpret her or put her own blush on it. Read the detail of it. It's a very good judgment. It's a very sound judgment, as indeed I said in my opening statement. And as for giving continuous votes and continuous information, I've been saying that all day today.
Sir Edward Lee.
The bill should be brief and the outcome simple, a point of principle. But is the Secretary of State aware that if the opposition parties combine to constrain the government's negotiating hand, for instance by insisting on staying in the single market, which would mean effectively will remain in the EU, is he aware that many of us believe that in those circumstances we should have an immediate general election, put it to the people, and that might concentrate the minds of the Labour Party?
Well, he's asking me a question. He's asking me a question which is way above my pay grade, to say the least, and the person whose pay grade it is has left now. But the point I'd make to my honourable friend is this. I would hope every member in this House would actually see it as their duty to their own constituents to deliver the best outcome, and that's precisely what the government's strategy is, to deliver the best outcome for Britain in this negotiation.
Sammy Wilson.
Speaker, first of all, I'm pleased that the case that was presented to hand a veto to the Northern Ireland Assembly, a blatant attempt to overturn the result of the referendum, has failed. What could the Secretary of State tell us that now that the Northern Ireland Assembly has been collapsed by Sinn Féin, what arrangements there will be to have the issues which concern Northern Ireland raised prior to negotiations and during negotiations?
With respect to his first point, I mean, it's notable that the court was unanimous. Whilst it was the 8-3 judgment on the rest of the issue, it was unanimous on that matter of not allowing a veto to the executive. Now, in terms of maintaining not so much a relationship, an understanding of the issues that relate to Northern Ireland, last week when we had a joint ministerial committee, I wrote to the Northern Ireland Executive to ask them to continue to send ministers to represent the interests of Northern Ireland, because there, although the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, as it were, disappear in the interim, ministers stay in post just as in any other administration. And last week they did come, they did turn up, and I will continue to extend that invitation to that end. If that doesn't work, then we'll find some other bilateral way. He must take it as read. I view this as near the top of my priorities, if not actually the top of my priority, to preserve the situation in Northern Ireland, to preserve the border in its current state, not hardening it, and to preserve the interests of the Northern Irish people.
Peter Bone.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. No bill that goes through parliamentary scrutiny is not a better bill before it becomes an Act of Parliament. Could the Secretary of State announce when we are going to get a business statement so that we know the timetabling? Hopefully we'll have a day for second reading, but could I urge the Secretary of State to say that we will give ample time for the committee stage so the House can properly scrutinise it before the bill goes through to the Lords?
On his last point, that would be my intention, certainly. And on the first point, the business statement, well, there will be one on Thursday anyway. Bear in mind this is a 96-page judgment. The point, as I've said before, of going right to the Supreme Court was to ensure we got an authoritative, detailed, final judgment on what we need to do and how we need to do it. And we've got to study that carefully. So it'll take a little bit of time, but not very much. And then we will come back to the House as soon as possible thereafter. So it's entirely possible that Thursday's business statement may cover that.
Alison McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State keeps talking about certainty, but for my constituents working in the manufacturing supply chain, given the Prime Minister's statement specifically on the customs union, they have nothing but uncertainty about their jobs. So what exactly is wrong with the suggestion from the member for Rushcliffe that the government bring forward its policy on Brexit for a vote in this House?
Well, the Honourable Lady talks about certainty. We've got a two-year negotiation that's going to take place. There's nothing we can do to collapse that, and nothing we should do to collapse that. So that means there is a limit to the extent to which we can introduce certainty. By the way, I hadn't mentioned it up until then in this discussion. And there will be debate after debate. Article 50, there'll be debate on the policy. The Great Repeal Bill, there'll be debate on the policy. And in several subsequent pieces of primary legislation, there'll be debate on the policy. There'll be no shortage of debate or votes.
Sir Desmond Swain.
Any obligation placed on the government's negotiating position during the passage of this bill may subsequently be subject to judicial review with consequent delay. I hope that my right honourable friend will judge the intentions that have been announced to amend the bill in that light.
As my honourable friend, right honourable friend, knows, I view everybody with great charity and generosity, and I'll continue to do so.
Mrs. Helen Goodman.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Further to the question from the honourable member from Wellingborough, when the Labour government legislated for the Lisbon Treaty, Parliament had 25 days, including 11 days of committee of the whole House. We've got 66 days now before the 31st of March. How many days is the Secretary of State planning to give us?
Well, two things first. I think wasn't it the Lisbon Treaty which they promised a referendum which we never got? Selling a false bill of goods is not a very good example to parliaments around the world. This is Article 50. This is the triggering process only. Nothing more than the triggering process. There will be vast quantities of legislation, much more than the Lisbon Treaty, between now and the conclusion.
Mr. Jacob Rees-Mogg.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Has my right honourable friend noticed that those who now wail parliamentary sovereignty mean the yoke of Brussels? When they say scrutiny, they mean delay. And when they say respect, they mean condescension. Does he agree with me that the British people have voted and we must legislate?
As ever, my honourable friend speaks for England.
Tom Brake.
all trying to get the best deal for our constituents, and that's why the Liberal Democrats will seek to amend the Article 50 bill to give people their first say on the terms of the UK's future relationship with the European Union and government plans to crash out of the single market and the customs union, inflicting huge damage on families and businesses up and down the country. Why don't the government take this opportunity to boost their democratic credentials and simply agree to such a popular vote?
I would ask the Honourable Gentleman to exercise his brain on this matter. The consequence of putting a second referendum at the end of this negotiation is to invite every single member of the European Union who do not want us to leave to put the worst possible deal in the hope we'd change our mind. We are not going to do that.
Steve Baker.
Mr. Speaker, today we uphold the rule of law by respecting the Supreme Court judgment. Will he agree with me that both Houses of Parliament must now respect the result of the referendum by swiftly passing this necessary act?
My honourable friend is as right as ever.
Ms. Leslie.
The Secretary of State can see the phenomenal interest in the House in this particular issue, and he shouldn't be afraid of scrutiny. My honourable friend from Bishop Auckland asked earlier a question about how many days he would commit to proper scrutiny of all the issues surrounding Article 50 on the floor of the House. So can he accept that this bill is more important than the Lisbon Bill, more important than the Maastricht Treaty, and any attempt to curtail the opportunities for this House to scrutinise those issues would betray the fear that the government has of proper debate?
Let me say this to him, two things. I mean, firstly, I don't think I've ever been run away from scrutiny. I mean, I've spent more time in this matchbox than any other Secretary of State in the last 5 months. In terms of what he's saying about the importance of the bill, of course it's important. Of course it's important, but also, and indeed, I want to see as much time as we can possibly get for it to be discussed. But that's a matter, as I say, for the usual channels to discuss. But the point I make to him is this. Many people who see this bill as incredibly important, perhaps more than it really is, are seeing it as some sort of point of no return. The point of no return was passed on June 23rd last year. This is simply carrying out the instruction of the British people. We'll do so under the full scrutiny of Parliament and under the authorisation of Parliament, and we'll give time for that. But don't conflate that with the whole process of the bill. The whole process, of the negotiation will take much more than was given to Lisbon. Much, much more time was given to Lisbon, because that number of pieces of primary legislation will take more time than that.
Mrs. Anne Main.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The Honourable Member for Carshalton and Wallington talked about democracy. In fact, he's the only representative of his political party here today. Would it be very undemocratic, in my Honourable Friend's right Honourable Friend's opinion, if he were to go down to the House of Lords and encourage 120 unelected members of the House of Lords to play ping pong and mess about with this bill? We must deliver what the British people have asked for.
Well, I say to my honourable friend that I think the British public will be looking at both houses and expecting them to meet their democratic duty properly, which means actually not to thwart the bill, not to delay the bill unnecessarily, but to do a proper process of scrutiny and then deliver on the will of the people.
Lady Herman.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Speaker. The Supreme Court today has ruled very clearly that the devolved legislatures do not have legislative competence and capacity in relation to the United Kingdom leaving the European Union. And therefore, it must follow, logically, that the procedure called EVIL, but known by its long title as English Votes for English Laws, should not be applicable when we come to the Great Repeal Bill. EVIL, as a procedure, is deeply divisive in this House, is demeaning to those members who represent Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland. When the Secretary of State has said, and I believe him, that every effort will be made by this government to hold together the United Kingdom, it would be helpful today if the Brexit Secretary could rule out clearly the use of EVIL in terms of the Great Repeal Bill.
Well, I can't, off the top of my head, think of a circumstance in which it will apply, but it might. And the point I'd say to her is that's I think, rests on a ruling by the Speaker, not by a Secretary of State.
Jonathan Ginogli.
Will triggering Article 50 be adequate to release us from other related treaty obligations under the 72 Act, such as our membership of the EEA?
Well, that's a debatable matter of law, I think, is the accurate answer to the Honourable Gentleman. And there may be subsequent matters that arise after the triggering of Article 50, but if so, we'll come back to the House.
Chris Bryant.
There's no reason why the government shouldn't get its bill through all the proper stages in this House and in the other House by the end of March. But can I just urge the Secretary of State that when the business managers come knocking and say we should condense the processes, that we should have several different stages on the same day, that the old member who flourished for 20 years on the back benches returns and fights hard for this House to say we will do the process properly.
I'll thank him not to refer to me as the old member. But of course, I will ensure that we get proper scrutiny.
I don't think the Right Honourable Gentleman's got another birthday until December. I think it's December the 23rd. You've got a long time to wait. Nothing to worry about. Victoria Atkins.
Today, British judges in the highest court in the land decided a point of historic constitutional importance, which was unprecedented in law. It was therefore right to seek the judgment of the Supreme Court to enable them to discover the law, as us lawyers euphemistically call it. Crucially, the Supreme Court recognised the limits of its constitutional powers when it left the form of that legislation to this Parliament. Is this not our Constitution thriving in action, and does it not bode well for the future?
My honourable friend is exactly right, and she goes to the point that I made before at this dispatch box. That's why we took it all the way to the Supreme Court. It was, by the way, not just the issue of Article 50 and the House of Commons' right role in that, but also, of course, the role of the devolved administrations, which had to go to the Supreme Court in any event.
David Winnick.
Is the Minister aware that many of us warmly congratulate the judges, the Supreme Court and the High Court, for upholding parliamentary sovereignty, which the government to a large extent tried to bypass in triggering Article 50. The judges are not the enemies of the people, they're defenders of parliamentary democracy.
I don't think if he goes back through this old member's extensive experience, he'll find me ever referring to the judges the enemies of the people, just the converse. It is occasionally embarrassing to me that I sometimes use them.
Mr. Dominic Raab.
I welcome the statement by the Secretary of State and also paragraph 122 of the Supreme Court ruling, which narrowed the scope of the rather opaque High Court ruling and allows us to pass a short, sharp bill to trigger Article 50. Does he agree with me that it's the responsibility of every Democrat in both houses to give effect to the will of the British people by passing that bill without delay?
I agree with my right honourable friend, and for my part, I will endeavour to make this bill as straightforward and as comprehensible as possible. The reason I say that is not just for speed, it's also because the public will be watching us, and the public will want to know what it is we're voting on and to understand it, so nothing opaque. So we will aim to present a straightforward, simple bill, which we'll take through as fast as is consistent with proper scrutiny.
Abardell.
Mr. Speaker, paragraph 151 of the Supreme Court ruling says the Seoul Convention has an important role in facilitating harmonious relationships between the UK Parliament and the devolved legislatures. What will he do, therefore, to ensure there is a harmonious relationship? Does he agree with the ruling? And will he produce a white paper, as proposed by the SNP, and actually write something down, as he didn't do that ahead of the EU referendum?
Well, that section, if I remember correctly, ends with the phrase that nobody has a veto. No devolved administration has a veto. In terms of involving and looking after the interests, or trying to help assist the interests of the devolved administrations and the people they represent, we have got a whole process in place, a joint ministerial committee, which does nothing but consider these matters, consider the interests of the nations of the United Kingdom, and to ensure that none of their special interests, none of their special political situations, none of their special economic situations are harmed in any way.
Mr. Christopher Jupe.
Mr. Speaker, there have been a couple of references to paragraph 122 of the Supreme Court judgment. It says there is no equivalence between the constitutional importance of a statute and its length or complexity. And a notice under Article 50 could be very short. Does my right honourable friend agree that that's a very important message for members of the opposition?
Yeah.
I take my honourable friend's point, and I will seek for incisive brevity.
Liz Kendall.
The Prime Minister says that no deal is better than a bad deal, but ending up on WTO rules could be the worst possible deal, hitting businesses and families hard. So can I press the Secretary of State? Will there be a vote in this House at the end of the trade negotiations, not just the Article 50 process, but the trade negotiations, so that Parliament can decide what is in Britain's national economic interest?
Well, apart from correcting us slightly, there won't be a simple trade negotiation. The European Union pretty much always insists on nothing is agreed until everything is agreed, so justice and home affairs and security matters and a whole series of other issues will be tied into it. But yes, there will be a vote at the end of it. We've already agreed that.
This is Cheryl Murray.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. There's been a lot of talk of second referendums on Article 50 from some on the opposite side of the House. Will my honourable friend please reassure my constituents, the majority of who voted to leave, that he will categorically rule out any second referendum?
Well, yes is the answer. I'm afraid I take the view that somehow the British people didn't know what they were doing first time round, so they've got to get a chance to get the answer right, is patronising, bluntly, and undemocratic, and improper. So and rightly held by one of the smallest parties in this House. The answer is I will not under any circumstances be supporting a second referendum.
Howell Williams.
Mr. Speaker, the Welsh Labour government and Plaid Cymru as the official opposition have in good faith come together to establish our Brexit aims, which they published yesterday as a white paper. Why will he not do likewise?
Well, I spoke to Carwyn Jones yesterday about that. I haven't actually had the chance to read it in detail yet. I know the headlines, and he took me through them. And it struck me as a very constructive submission to the process. And we will be debating it at the next joint ministerial committee.
William Ragg.
Joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth. Will my right honourable friend join with me in sharing my delight that those who were previously happy for sovereignty to be dispatched to Brussels now believe in the sovereignty of the United Kingdom Parliament?
Apart from the fact I would warn him to be wary of biblical quotations, the last time I used one, it was about get thee behind me, Satan. It rode with me for several weeks thereafter. But he's right. He's right. This is a massive exercise in democracy, and we will make it so.
Paul Flynn.
The Supreme Court's judgment is welcome in establishing that the will of this House is superior, is sovereign to the royal prerogative, but is unwelcome in seeking to take back from Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland powers that have been devolved to them. Can we promise that the special needs of Wales, who will be hit more severely by withdrawal from the single market than England will, and we'll have not just a red, white and blue Brexit, it's a red, white and green breakfast that meets the will and needs of Wales?
Well, I'll say two things. I mean, firstly, I think he misreads the judgment. It doesn't talk about taking back powers from the devolved administrations at all, as far as I can see. As I answered to the Plaid Cymru member, the interests of the people of Wales have been put together, or the Welsh government's view of them have been put together in a paper which has been submitted to the Joint Ministerial Committee and will be debated at the next meeting of the European negotiating arm of that committee.
Shailesh Vara.
Mr. Speaker, the Supreme Court judgment was decisive in its reference and the position of the devolved assemblies. Given that is the case, would my right honourable friend agree with me that now is the time for the states' women and states' men of the devolved assemblies to respect the decision of the Supreme Court and to work constructively with the government for the greater good of the United Kingdom, of which they are very much a part.
I could not have put it better myself.
Oriana Piero.
Speaker, I will vote to trigger Article 50, but I also have a duty to scrutinise the government deal to ensure it does not make my constituents poorer. I also think my constituents, as taxpayers, have a right to know how much the appeal, the Supreme Court appeal, costs them. Would you tell us?
Good question.
On the latter point, I don't have that number in my mind, but I can. Well, I don't. I mean, I've been studying the agreement today, not the agreement, the judgment. But I will. I'll give it. I'll send it. I'll provide it to her as soon as I can. I mean, that'll be quickly. Can I just say this, however, about the spending of money on a Supreme Court judgment? I'm quite sure it'll be expensive at one level. I'm sure it will be because lawyers are expensive, as the spokesman will tell you. I'm sure he's a much more expensive lawyer. That's the greatest compliment I can pay him. Let me make a more fundamental point to her, and it's this: when we're dealing with something as important as this, and I don't think anybody in the House questions the importance of the constitutional decision that's been made today, then it's incredibly important it's made on solid ground, it's made with proper authority, it's made in a way which the government can interpret properly to deliver the right outcome. And it's a point I've made across this dispatch box more than once, and therefore, frankly, it will be worth whatever we paid for it.
Mr. Philip Ollivan.
Right honourable friend for being the right man in the right place at the right time. Yeah. 61% of the people in Kettering voted to leave the European Union. They will take comfort that there's nothing in today's judgment that will delay the process, and they will like the fact that their Member of Parliament will obey their instructions and vote to trigger Article 50. May I commend all other members to do the same?
Yeah.
I thank you for that. All I can say is I'm surprised it was only 61% in his constituency.
Yeah. Mark Durkin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The judgment's terms tell us that we should not rely on mere political convention for legal adherence or political confirmation on key matters. That being so, Sewell will be meaningless in the context of the Great Repeal Bill, but also does the Secretary of State recognise that the key constitutional precept of the Good Friday Agreement in terms of the principle of consent and the potential, the democratic potential for a united Ireland, is something that is going to have to be explicitly included in any new UK-EU treaty if those provisions, that those are issues are a matter for the people of Ireland without external impediment, are to be fully reflected on the terms of the Supreme Court judgment today properly reflected?
Yeah. Well, I'm not going to reiterate the fact of the Supreme Court judgment on the Irish aspect, Northern Irish aspect of the question today. He can read that much more authoritatively in the judgment. I've said to him before in this House, and I'll reiterate it to him again, there's more than one guarantee on this. The British government is determined to preserve the peace settlement and all that underpins it. The Irish government is determined to underpin it. And so, actually, is the Commission. I'll say something nice about the Commission on this, because when I spoke to Michel Barnier, my opposite number, he reminded me he was involved in the original peace process himself, and so all of the parties to this have a vested interest in delivering what he wants.
Stephen Hammond.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. You will, as I will recall last week, my right honourable friend extolling the fact he liked to please his boss. And he was also saying earlier what a wonderful speech he made last week. Can I say to him, he could unify the whole side of the House by publishing a white paper based on his, our honourable friend's, our boss's excellent speech, and I'm sure that would make him even more popular with our boss.
Given, I thought I was really rather restrained given she was sitting there today. I could have been thoroughly oleaginous. But I wasn't prompted by the Honourable Lady from Roxburgh this time, you see, who gave me the line last time about Her Majesty, I think it was.
Nearly.
Nearly, said, yes, absolutely, absolutely. I won't go rehearse all of the arguments again. I will provide whatever information I can, as much information as I can, as promptly as I can, bearing in mind this is a process that's likely to start next week.
Owen Smith. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I agree with the Secretary of State. The Prime Minister was very, very clear last week in his speech that we are now leaving the single market and likely the customs union. Before the referendum, his government said that that would cost the British people £66 billion, or roughly the half the cost of the NHS per year. Does the government stand by that estimate, or is there a different estimate? And could the Secretary of State tell us what it is today?
I'll say two things to him. I mean, the first thing is this, that I think it was Andy Haldane, of the Deputy Governor of the Bank of England, talked about a Michael Fish moment for economic forecasters. Something he might deliberate upon the next time he wants to ask a question like this. The second point I'll make to him, however, is this. Economic models and economic forecasts are only as good as the assumptions that go into them. And the point that the Prime Minister was making last week was not just that we're going to be not members of the single market, but that we are going to seek the freest and most barrier-free access in the interest of people of Wales and others. We're going to seek that. But the negotiation is not complete yet, but we're going to seek that. That's our aim, and if we succeed, it will be hugely valuable for the people of Wales.
Mr. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The EU referendum saw a 72% turnout for a clear vote for leaving the European Union, showing a strongly held will by the British people. Does my right honourable friend agree with me that the Liberal Democrat call for a second referendum, I think one honourable member turned up today, and now not here, shows that they don't care about the public view unless they get their way?
Well, I'm tempted, looking across the chamber, to say what Liberal Democrat, but the and as she said, there was only one here at the most, which shows just how seriously they take this incredibly important issue. I think the public at large will take a view of the Liberal Democrats on this, which is that they're trying to use this for their own political purposes, not for the national interest.
Heidi Alexander.
Speaker, there have been a lot of questions, understandably, today about process, but there is also an emerging Brexit reality in the country for which this government is responsible. 1,000 jobs going from London to Paris with HSBC, Toyota, Lloyds of London, UBS and Nissan all reviewing their operations. Exactly how many jobs is the government prepared to lose to other European countries whilst we negotiate our exit from the EU?
Well, I could stand here for about 10 minutes saying things like Apple, Google, Microsoft, all those companies who've decided, McDonald's, companies decide to be here. I'll say this to her. We have pretty much the highest employment and the lowest unemployment for a considerable time, completely contrary to the pessimistic predictions of many people after the Brexit result. And I'm afraid if you want to look at a demonstration of how badly wrong the establishment of Britain got this, just look at those numbers.
David Rutley.
Exiting the EU is uncharted territory. There will be naturally uncertainties and challenges along the way. Will my right honourable friend tell the House what steps he's taking and the government's taking to communicate with British businesses to ensure that we can build confidence and foster economic growth in the months ahead?
To be frank, I mean, I can send him the numbers, but they're beyond counting now. I mean, the number of meetings we've had with manufacturing, aviation, tourism, finance, banking, insurance, and so on. My ministers, but not just ministers in my department, ministers all across government are talking to their own client industries, as it were, to ensure that they know what their concerns are, they know what the opportunities are, and they know what policy measures we have to take to maximise the opportunities and mitigate any concerns. And I think what we are beginning to see, it took a few months, but what we're beginning to see is a change in mood to see the opportunity rather than the concern. And that's an incredibly important change in mood in our country.
It gapes.
Secretary of State has twice said that the point of no return was on June the 23rd. He's ruled out a white paper, he's ruled out a vote on a plan. Does he agree that neither the words customs union nor single market were on the ballot paper? And if this House decides that it does not wish to proceed at some point with the process after Article 50 has been triggered, do we then leave automatically, or is it reversible?
Let me say firstly to him about the what was not on the ballot paper. Listening to people say this is rather like saying, you said you're going to sell the car, you didn't tell me you're going to sell the engine and the tyres as well. I mean, these components, these elements of the common external tariff barrier, the common commercial policy, the rule of the European Court of Justice, all these things are components of the European Union, which the public voted to leave. So that's the first thing I'd say to him. Beyond that, he also misquotes me. He misquotes me in terms of the of what I've said already about the votes and debates. There will be any number of votes and debates in the coming 2 years, many of them about the issues he talked about.
Mr. Robert Jenrick. I fully support the words from all quarters today in support of our judges, who really are the best, most inscrutable and highest quality I've seen anywhere in the world. But those warm words, would my right honourable friend agree, need to be matched by action by all members in the House today, and in particular, just as the government are supporting and accepting the verdict today, that members accept the words of the Supreme Court in respect of the fact that a small bill can have just the power of a larger one, and that those from some of the devolved parts of the United Kingdom accept the verdict too. And in terms of cost, would my right honourable friend, if he's publishing the cost of the government in the Supreme Court, ask the devolved assemblies, particularly in Scotland, to publish how much taxpayers' money has been spent joining the action?
I'll pick up cost. As I said, I'll provide the numbers on cost. There's no problem with doing that. But I'll make one point in all of this. We were not the people who brought the case. So, the cost of this is a direct outcome of that. Now, I am not one of those. Sort of animal noises from the other side, notwithstanding. I am not one of those who criticise the people who brought the case. I think they brought a very important constitutional case, which is why I said whatever it cost, it was worth doing. But do not say to the government, why did you defend the case? Why did you carry the case? Because a massively important constitutional issue was at stake. And my honourable friend is right. We should all take it very seriously and take it as the status of our law today and obey it accordingly.
Pete Wishart.
Mr. Speaker, we're supposed to have the most powerful devolved parliament in the world. Scotland Acts have told us now that it's permanent. Scotland Acts have also told us that the Sewell Convention is embedded into law. We now know, of course, that these Scotland Acts are barely worth the vellum they're written on. Now, the Secretary of State is saying he is listening to Scotland. That's great, he said that several times today. But when is he going to do something? When is he going to act? Because if he doesn't accept the very reasonable proposals we put to him, the Scottish people are going to ask very quickly, what is the point of being here at all?
The first thing I'd say to him is, if I remember it correctly, the Supreme Court's comments on the Sewell Convention were really that it wasn't for the judges to decide. But the point I will also make to him is this: I listened last week at great length to the Scottish Government Minister present the arguments in their paper. And as I said earlier to one of his colleagues, there are bits of it we disagree with. There are bits of it that we absolutely agree with. I mean, the most obvious one from my point of view is the protection of employment law, which I take very, very seriously indeed. And we're absolutely on the same place on that. And I talked through with him, and others in the committee talked through with him, the issue of devolution. And the clear point was no existing devolved powers were going to be withdrawn or retracted. Of course, that's not going to happen. But we've also got to think in rational terms, in the interests of Scottish people and the wider citizens of the United Kingdom, where the best place for decisions to be made is. And I would prefer, in most cases, to devolve powers. But in some circumstances, it's not practical. And that's what we have to do. We have to do what's right for the people, not what suits our political interests.
Mr. Richard Drax.
Speaker, I'm confident that every member of this House will vote to trigger Article 50,
for which one of us would dare thwart the will of the people.
Yeah.
Does my right honourable friend share my one concern, though, that the implications of this case could have an effect on, for example, the government's decision to go to war? Could that now be challenged, for example, by a member of the public?
No, I mean, I don't think he's right on that. I mean, as I said, it's a 96-page judgment, so we've got to go through the detail of it. But this was confined to two aspects, or at least the major part of the case was confined to two aspects, the implication specifically for the ECA and the implication for those treaties which have an effect on the domestic legal rights of citizens. And I don't think that the decision to go to war would fall within that. However, he raises more broadly a very important point, because we are in an era when the exact reach of the royal prerogative is something that has to be established and understood, particularly when we are once again in complete command of our own future, and we have to be able to know what we can and can't do as a government, what we have to do in conjunction with Parliament, where we have to go back for authorisation. And that's one of the reasons we're taking a good deal of time to read this judgment.
Anna Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State has mentioned a few times about this being a massive exercise in democracy. And I just wanted to put to him that a very useful tool in a participatory democracy is issuing white papers. And I really do not understand why the Secretary of State has set his face so against doing that when we're about to make the most important decision of many, many generations and trigger Article 50.
One of the things that was said by, unfortunately not here, the Chairman of the Select Committee is not here now, one thing that was said by the Chairman of the Select Committee was that they wanted the plan as quickly as possible before the middle of February. I actually said to the Select Committee it would be very difficult to turn out a sort of white paper, full white paper before then. One of the virtues of delivering this via a Prime Ministerial speech of some length was that we could do it quickly. We can make it very clear, and everybody would understand it. And it got coverage around the world in a way which wouldn't have been available for any other medium. Now, the point that matters here, and people remind me and sometimes tease me, of course, about my history as an activist for parliamentary rights. And the important part to remember about all of that is that we're only here because we represent our constituents. We represent people's interest. And what I have done, or tried to do so far, is to provide as much, I keep reiterating the phrase, I'm afraid, as much information as possible. Now, let's just take the plan with respect to what was asked by the Labour front bench and by the Select Committee. They asked, what are we going to do about the single market? Hopefully that's now plain. Asked what we do about the customs union. Hopefully that's now plain. What we're going to do about justice and affairs. Hopefully that's now plain. What role do they see for Britain in the world? Hopefully that's now plain. Now, of course, what we can't do is say what the outcome of the negotiation will be. We can't give that level of certainty, but we can certainly give a level of certainty, and as we have and as we will, as to what the aims and strategic objectives are, and we've done that.
Ben Howland.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I also welcome today's judgment by the Supreme Court, and also would like to lend my support to the Supreme Court judges, and I hope we don't see any repeat of the bile that was directed towards the High Court judges last year in the papers tomorrow. But while I welcome the Prime Minister's speech last week focusing on a comprehensive free trade agreement, I have received thousands of emails and correspondence from my constituents, all wanting to have their say on this issue. After all, 70% of them voted to remain inside the European Union. Does my right honourable friend therefore agree, as other colleagues have said, and without wishing to make him repeat himself again, that the best way to do this and to make sure that my constituents' views are heard are via the use of a white paper?
Well, I'm afraid he's failed in not making me repeat myself. Plainly, what the House has determined that I would fail in, what is it, just a minute or whatever the quiz is where you're not allowed to repeat yourself, I'd fail miserably. I reiterate, it's the facts that matter. It's the plan that matters. It's answering Parliament's questions that matter. We've done all of those things. We'll continue. I will continue to provide whatever information I can without compromising our negotiating position, and I'll do that.
Danny Kinahan.
Thank you very much.
More than your own view.
I thank the Secretary of State for his answer to the Honourable Member for East Antrim, where he said he's written to the Northern Ireland Executive. But would he recognise that the Northern Ireland Executive has collapsed after just 8 months and may not have the confidence of the people of Northern Ireland, and in fact that they had no joint plan? Would the Secretary of State make sure that he writes to all parties and includes everyone so he gets something that tells all of us where we're going? We accept the result, we need quick resolution, but we must all be included. Would he do so? Thank you.
He raises an interesting point. I mean, before I answer directly, can I say this, that of course I've sought to get the parties in the executive to continue sending a minister to the joint ministerial committee, but that's only one mechanism, of course. There are others. I mean, we'll be speaking, I think the Prime Minister is speaking to the Taoiseach next week, so the Irish government interest will be represented. And I've, of course, talked to others more directly. And I went over to Northern Ireland very early on in my time in this job. But let me, I'm inclined to say yes to him. I'll write them all, but let me just consider carefully that I'm not going to sort of land myself in some problem. The reason I'm being cautious is because there's now an election underway. And I've got to be very wary of the British government appearing to sort of meddle in any aspect of the election. So let me just take pause and think about that. And I will do what I judge is in the best interest of Northern Ireland. He must take that as my promise.
After faster progress for a while, the pace has slowed terribly in the last few minutes. So what is required is a pithy question of the kind in which a Queen's Council should specialise. Let us hear about the contents of the textbook. Pithily, Lucy Fraser.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Supreme Court, in terms at the beginning of its judgment, indeed on its very first page, stated that it wanted to emphasise the case had absolutely nothing to do with the terms of withdrawal, the arrangements for withdrawal, or the details as to any future relationship with Europe. In those circumstances, does the Secretary of State agree with me that all the Supreme Court decided was that before pulling the trigger, there needed authorisation by Act of Parliament? And under the terms of the judgment, at least, there is no obligation to set out the details of any deal. Speaker, within today's judgment, it states that notwithstanding new legislative constraints, and I quote, the EU will enhance the devolved competence. I asked the Secretary of State this same question just last week and was dismayed that he was only able to provide his presumption. So can he now provide actual concrete examples of which types of powers will be devolved to the devolved administrations following our exit from the European Union?
All right, so I rather suspect she misquotes me from last week. What I said, or what I should have said, was that there are some elements of the powers that come back to the European Union which will go to the devolved administration. Some will stay in the centre, but there will be a number over which we're going to have to debate the matter and decide, and that will happen in the first instance in a joint ministerial committee and then at Cabinet.
Single sentence questions, please, with the abandonment of any preamble that colleagues might have had in mind. Matt Warman.
Can I invite the Secretary of State, while he should take seriously amendments proposed to the forthcoming legislation in good faith, he should give short shrift to those who seek to use amendments to derail or delay a vital process?
Yeah. I will.
Stephen Doughty.
Mr. Speaker, the State already attempted to sideline Parliament by appealing this case and by refusing to publish a white paper. So can he be very, very clear? Will the bill be drafted in such terms as to allow not just amendments, but substantive amendments? Yes or no?
I've been here 30 years. If he knows how to draft a bill that withstands any amendments, I'd like to hear about it.
The names are we.
In any negotiation, it's worth thinking about the other side. Lord Hill, who knows a thing or two about Europe, came and gave evidence to our committee and said what the best strategy for negotiation is to now come together because the decision has been made. Otherwise, you'd be sending a mixed message to your interlocutors. Does the Secretary of State agree?
Yes, and I would hope that once we get through the Article 50 process, we will see a rather more collegiate attitude from all parts of the political spectrum. This is, after all, a national interest that's engaged.
you. I went to him.
Peter Gow.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State a moment ago reminded us that our job is to do what's in the best interest of our constituents. The city I represent has 8.5 million visitors to it each year. It has two universities, and it has an economy that includes the head offices of EDF and MX. If I do not believe that between now and March, the guarantees offered by this government will protect everything that is great about my city, surely he would agree with me that I cannot support this timescale.
I'm not about to protect him from his constituents, I'm afraid. My comment to him is this. We're in a negotiation. If he can point to me a negotiation that had guarantees before it started, I'd be interested to hear about it.
Kevin Foster.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm sure the Secretary of State will agree that it's strange that many seem to be unaware that legislative changes will be needed on a whole range of issues as we leave, not just on the Article 50 point. But would he agree with me distinctly that if people try and use tricks of procedure in this House or anywhere else to try and frustrate Article 50, they'll just fuel the scepticism that push people to vote leave?
That's true, and I think their constituents will notice too.
Now, somebody who's been waiting a long time must have been able to work out how to do it in a short sentence. Neil Gray, let's hear it.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Given a legislative consent motion is apparently now a political decision and there is no impediment for the government to bring one, can he advise the House, if the government had a legislative consent contingency in place before the Supreme Court ruling, and why on earth would he rule out bringing one now?
Because I said that no component part of the United Kingdom has a veto. I've said that dozens of times in this House, if you've been listening.
That's all.
Speaker, can my right honourable friend reassure my Bury North constituents, a majority of whom will vote to leave, that he will allow nothing to get in the way of ensuring that the bill that he has announced will be passed as quickly as possible?
Yes.
Ian Blackford, a sentence.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State said in his statement that this government is determined to deliver on a decision taken by the people of the United Kingdom, but of course, in Scotland, the country that those of us on these benches represent, voted to remain within the United Kingdom, and the Scottish Government has been empowered by the Parliament to make sure that we remain within the single market. Why is he acting against the best interests of the Scottish people? And will he not understand if he refuses to accept our will, then our only ultimate...
Too long, too loud. We don't want to hear it. Enough. Secretary of State.
Number one, I don't necessarily think the interests of the Scottish National Party are the same as those of the Scottish people. Number two, as I remember, the Scottish nation voted to stay inside the United Kingdom, that United Kingdom which voted to leave the European Union.
Chris Green.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The World Trade Organization has done a fantastic amount of work to reduce trade barriers around the world. It's the basis of our trading relationship with the United States of America, where we have a trade surplus. Would my right honourable friend agree with me that this is a great foundation for a trade deal with the EU, and it's for the EU now to do something better than that?
I agree.
Susan Owen-Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State has spoke a great deal about listening to the devolved nations, but will he listen to what they have to say about the importance of unfettered access to the single market?
We already have. That was the point that the Prime Minister was making when she said we wanted a free, barrier-free, most facilitated trade with the EU.
Martin Vickers.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can my right honourable friend assure the 70% of my constituents who voted for Brexit that if the upper house were to attempt to thwart or delay the bill, he has a contingency plan to ensure we meet the March deadline?
From what I remember of my honourable friend's constituency, he has enough members of the upper house in it to tell them himself.
Alan Brown.
When the Secretary talks about not thwarting the will of the people, will he finally recognise that 62% of people in Scotland voted to stay? The Scottish Government is not asking for a veto. The Scottish Government is asking for a compromise of Scotland maintaining membership of the single union. When will they actually work with him to achieve that?
As I've said to several of his colleagues, his honourable colleagues, we work at the Joint Ministerial Committee, we work bilaterally, we seek to protect the interests of the whole United Kingdom, including not least Scotland.
Okay. I don't want to frustrate the process, but is he saying that the referendum result is the only factor that should govern the Article 50 vote, and isn't that tantamount to signing a black check and setting aside the views of our constituents.
Now, when the question starts, well, I don't want to frustrate the process, but it tells you something in its own right. Now, look, this is the government seeking authorization to trigger the start of the negotiation, which was what the British people voted for last year. End of story. That's why. It's not the only issue, but it is the most important issue.
Ronnie Cowan.
This judgment rode roughshod through the Seoul Convention, so can the Minister assure me that he will seek meaningful discussions with the Scottish Government, discussions that respect and reflect the desire of the Scottish electorate to remain in the EU?
Well, I think the Scottish Government was represented or its case was represented to the Supreme Court, and I'm unlike the Honourable Gentleman, I don't pick and choose which bits I like or don't like. I go along with the Supreme Court because it's the highest court in our land and we have to obey it.
Yeah. Greenwood.
Speaker, the country voted to leave, but my constituents did not vote for a cut in their living standards. There are genuine and serious concerns about the impact on our economy, on manufacturing, on higher education and research if the UK left the EU without a deal and fell back on WTO rules. What assessment has he made of the risks of leaving with no deal in place? And will he publish that assessment so it can be subject to proper scrutiny?
Number one, there were a great number of forecasts of how terrible things would be if the people voted Brexit. They were all undiluted wrong. Every single one was wrong. And our strategy, our strategic aim, is to get a comprehensive free trade agreement. Not to fail to do so, but to get one. And that's what will protect her constituents, if she's willing to pay attention to it.
Richie.
Speaker, the Secretary of State refers to the fact that he wants to preserve the interests of the people of Northern Ireland and that he understands the peace settlement. Currently, we are in an election process which will be quickly followed by negotiations of which Brexit will form an important part. In discussions with the Taoiseach and with the Irish Government, will he ensure that special status is very well considered for Northern Ireland and as part of those negotiations ensuing the elections?
There are a whole series of special circumstances that apply. I mean, when I first went to visit Northern Ireland since I've become been in this post, the sorts of things that came up were the importance of the border, were the things like the single energy market, a whole series of things like that, and we'll continue to pay attention to them. Now, if you'll forgive me, I'm going to be very careful about answering questions because of the ongoing election, but I think she should take it as read. We take this very, very seriously indeed.
Peter Grant.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Secretary of State for Scotland, who is no longer in his place, has told this House on at least five occasions that the Sewell Convention was being placed on a statutory footing by the Scotland Act. The Supreme Court today has said it's not. Which of these two contradictory judgments currently holds the confidence of Her Majesty's Government?
No, it's not a contradictory judgment. This is a reserved matter.
Dr. Lisa Cameron.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Surely the ruling confirms that Brexit means Brexit has been totally inadequate as any explanation to Parliament or its people. The devil is often in the detail, particularly the Tory detail. Surely that detail should be given in the form of a white paper.
She's not the first person to ask, obviously, but it's perhaps one of the more partisan requests for a white paper. Look, the issue here is the strategic aims are very clear. And those strategic aims are designed to protect the interests of the people she represents.
Grady.
Speaker, I noticed that the judgment was issued during the court's Hillary term, and I hope someone's going to explain exactly what that means to the Trump administration. I wonder if he could tell us why it's right that unelected peers will now have more of a say over the Article 50 process than elected members of the devolved institutions.
Thank you.
I'm trying to think what the significance of Hillary term is, except in the context of the chairman of the Select Committee on Brexit. I'm afraid I frankly didn't hear half of his question, so I'm going to have to write to him on that. Yeah? Sorry? I couldn't hear that either. I'll answer later.
Mr. Blackburn.
much. Mr. Speaker, there are rules in place to ensure that Parliament can scrutinise legislation as it passes through this House. Will the Secretary of State commit today to ensuring that those rules stay in place and that there are two clear weekends between first and second reading?
Hear, hear.
That's a matter for the usual channels, not for me.
Stephen Paterson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Scottish Government's published a detailed set of proposals on maximising a relationship ongoing with the European Union. So does the Secretary of State recognise that refusing to publish a white paper is tantamount to political cowardice?
I really don't think so. I've never been accused of cowardice before, so I'm not quite sure how to respond, but the answer is no.
Tommy Shepherd.
Mr. Speaker, I'm becoming increasingly concerned at the way in which supporters of the government's view are trying to delegitimise the opinions of others by suggesting that their intention is to thwart the decision to leave the European Union. So can I ask him to confirm to this House that, having read the Scottish Government's position, that there is no part of that document which suggests that either Scotland or indeed any other part of the United Kingdom should do anything other than leave the European Union?
I have been very careful in the period since I received that document not to criticise it publicly, because I wanted to have that debate. I was chairing the Joint Ministerial Committee, so I didn't want to, as it were, colour the chairing of the debate. Let me say this to him. I mean, I said before, if you put it in three categories, there are bits which I didn't think would work, there are bits where we are subject to debate, particularly on the devolution issues, and there are bits where we're absolutely on the same page on matters like employment law. But there are elements of the paper which will have run into problems not just with the United Kingdom government, but with other members of the European Union. It was criticised by the Spanish Europe Minister, and it was criticised implicitly by senior Norwegians on the EFTA front. So you know, I don't think that you can hold it up as some sort of ideal model of a perfect outcome.
Order. I'm grateful to the Secretary of State, the opposition spokespersons, and to all 84 backbench members who took part in this important series of exchanges.